It is working. Hi, everybody. This is Robert Jacobson here in beautiful Southern California, and I'm here with my friend Paul Romero. He's coming to us live from his home in Sherman Oaks, and Paul is a classical pianist and a composer, and I'm pretty excited to speak to him today. I met Paul about a year ago through a mutual friend named Jolo Piccolo, and there's been some interesting, I guess, collaborative opportunities that have emerged for Paul through our recent friendship through Jolo Piccolo. So we have Joe to thank. Some of you gaming enthusiasts might know Paul's name through some of the work he's done. He's worked on over 70 original soundtrack and for games for film and computer game scores, including games for Ubisoft and the series Heroes of Might and Magic, which I think is quite popular. Paul is the exclusive and sole composer of, which he'll can correct me if I'm not right there. And some of his themes for the Heroes soundtrack are quite popular. And he's also composed for the massive multiplayer online game EverQuest. And I think he's won a Jerry Goldsmith Award, some NEA grants, and done some other incredible work. And he's also known as the Von Kleinburn, he won the Von Kleinburn Amateur Piano Competition several years ago, of which maybe we'll dive into a little bit. So Paul, thank you very much. Thanks for joining
us today. Thank you, Robert. Thank you for talking to me.
Oh, absolutely. So, Paul, want to tell me a little bit about tell us a bit about your background and how you got into music, and just a little bit of your early background.
Well, let's see. When I was a little boy, my mom bought a piano when I was about 3 years old for decoration, and I just every day would walk past this thing that was supposed to be pretty in our living room and kind of tinkered on the keys and started figuring out, you know, if you push this key and that key together, it sounds nice. And if you push that one and this one, it doesn't sound nice. And you start little by little figuring out these little combinations. And, you know, by the time I was four, I was already teaching myself how to play, you know, full on songs. Whatever I heard on the radio, I could like duplicate. So by the time I was 9 years old, my parents, I was already playing piano concertos that I heard on either through an album or on the radio, but it was just by ear. I didn't really know what I was doing. I couldn't read notes or anything. But my parents thought, well, he doesn't need music lessons because he's already playing the damn piano. So why would he need lessons? He's already doing it. But then some of my parents' more educated friends, because my parents, you know, they're very simple people. They weren't college educated, and so some of their friends thought, well, you know, Paul might grow up to be a professional musician, so might be a good idea that he knows what he's doing. So then they recommended that I take formal music lessons. So I started formal training when I was 9 years old in composition and in classical piano performance. So it was a while to kind of learn how to read notes, because my playing ability was so high, but my ability to read notes was zero. So to try to learn how to read notes at the level of my finger ability took a couple years. So, and then when I was 11, by the time I was 11, I made my professional debut playing a piano concerto with the Santa Monica Symphony. So that was my first like concert debut, and then I started traveling around. I kind of was sort of becoming like a prodigy, because in addition to playing the piano, I was starting to compose large scale works like piano concertos and stuff like that, of my own. And so the Yamaha Music Corporation started sponsoring tours. So I think my first trip was 11 or 12, and I started playing in Japan, and they started sending me all over the U.S. and, you know, around the world to do concerts, playing my music, playing my own compositions. And the reason why they did that was because I was enrolled in the Yamaha Music School, my local Yamaha Music School. They thought, well, if we put Paul on stage and audiences around the world could see how he, you know, he's able to create his own music and play the piano so well, you know, they're going to want to sign their kids up to Yamaha, the local Yamaha music schools. So I was sort of used as a promotional tool, I guess, but for my own pleasure, I traveled all over the place and I made my first recording when I was 11, and then did my first PBS television broadcast with Rostropovich and the National Symphony from the United Nations General Assembly Hall when I was 15, playing my own piano concerto, and that was a big benefit for UNICEF. And then after that, I enrolled at Curtis Institute of Music when I was 16 in Philadelphia. And once I got there, they realized, wow, he doesn't really know what he's doing. He's just like a monkey. Like, just he can do all kinds of things on stage, but he doesn't really know what he's doing. So they curtailed everything in my career. No more recordings, no more concerts, no more like fantasy La La Land of you know being put on stage as a promotional tour. Is they got me down to the nuts and bolts, and like literally had to learn how to construct a two-part invention, a three-part invention. I didn't know anything about orchestration. I didn't know anything about, you know, real piano repertoire, like, you know, Brahms and a lot of the Bach and Haydn and early Beethoven and Beethoven quartets. I mean, there was so much I didn't know that I had to literally start my music education kind of from scratch at 16.
Was that frustrating coming into college where you had a bit of a career and then you're sort of being told to curtail that career?
Well, it wasn't frustrating in that once I got to Curtis Institute and I saw my colleagues who were my age who could do circles around me. You know, they knew so much more than I did, the pianists and the composers, and they were all my age as well. So I realized all those years of me kind of being on the road and traveling, doing these sort of, these, I guess not vanity concerts, but promotional concerts, really did keep me from my education, because I was always preparing for concerts. And those are the years I probably should have been really studying hard. So it was cool. I mean, I got a young career, young prodigy career, and you know, I was in television, and I got to feel what it was like to be a well-known musician. But then it was sort of smoke and mirrors. Then I really had to start from scratch again, and I knew it. So it wasn't frustrating because I realized what I was missing. But once I finished Curtis, and then I went to the Paris Conservatory, and then I finished up at in London at the Guildhall School of Music and Drama when I was 21. There was just no place for me to go to start my music career again. It's like, where do you stand in line to get people to pay you to do music after that, especially as a pianist and as a composer? So I all of a sudden I was in a full grown adult, and you know, I tried to kind of reignite my career at that point, and nothing seemed to work. I wasn't winning any competitions. My music was very old fashioned sounding to people who would, you know, maybe be interested in putting me in a contemporary music program. So I ended up like dropping out of music when I was 21. So I became a cook. I sold ink for IBM for their printers. I got work in construction and catering companies. I worked at stores, you know, waitering, all kinds of. I did everything under the sun until I was 30. And when I was 30, I just figured, oh my God, my music career was so long ago that was just sort of a part of my childhood, and what am I going to do the rest of my life? And then a friend of mine who worked for a computer gaming company knew that I was a classically trained musician, and he asked me if I would come in and listen to this music that he was putting together for a new video game called Heroes of Might and Magic. And he said, you know, we really want the music to sound like it's from a long time ago and really takes you out of our current time period and really puts the listener in a different time zone. And so I listened, he goes, this music that we've come up with, it doesn't sound like that. He goes, can you tell us what's wrong and maybe give us some tips what we can do? So I listened to the music, and it was a rock and roll score, actually, that they had come up with, like bass guitar and drums and pads on the